Ken Laird, Guy Junker. Here on Trib Live Radio, TribLive.com. Always thrilled to be joined by our next guest. He has maybe the best job in the world. Best sports league on the planet. Best possible franchise in best sports league. I want to be Kevin Colbert. Guy Junker.
You don't see the pressures the man is under.
Because he's under pressure.
He's outwardly calm and cool. See, below the desk, his feet are like tapping real fast the whole time.
Kevin, do you have the best job on planet Earth?
I'm very, very fortunate. I'll say that, Kenny. It's really not pressure. It's fun. This is something that I'm very privileged to have the opportunity to do it. And every day, if it becomes work, then I'll probably find something else. But it's always enjoyable.
Kevin, are you glad when the draft is over? I mean, I know it's a lot of work and preparation, but the tools of your business now are there for you to work with rather than just dealing in generalities and what-ifs, which you were still doing even a week ago at this time.
Yeah, it's just a different phase, Guy. I mean, the college draft is it's a long process. It's a timely endeavor. It's, you know, there's a lot of work involved, and our scouts and our coaches do a tremendous job in trying to get us through that period. So that phase is ended, but really the search for talent will never stop. I mean, once we get the guys in here this weekend, we'll get a little better feel for not only the draft picks who we think we have a real good feel for, but maybe some of the free agents, and see if we think that some of these guys are going to be able to help us. If not, we'll continue to look at the veteran groups that's out there right now, or who may be out there from now until training camp, and see if there's anybody we can add to help.
Kevin, I know we've talked before, but I love old stories of things that happen on draft day, and we've talked before, and I know you've always said things are actually pretty calm, more than people think behind the scenes, because you're all on the same page. But can you give us any kind of a story from the old days? I'm thinking we're 10 years past the Polamalu pick. This is one of the great draft picks of all time. You guys moved up to get him. How about like a little nugget, something that was happening behind the scenes right before Troy got taken?
Right before Troy got taken, really, it was just a matter of systematically calling the teams. I can't quite remember where we started that process. You usually will start the process, you know, if we were picking, I think, I can't even remember where we picked that year.
27th, I think.
Yeah, I think we're 27. So if you felt the player was, you know, say he was our 12th best player on the board, well, you'd probably call the team with the 12th pick and start with them, because you value the player that much. So as the clock winds down, you go from team to team until you find a taker. And, you know, we actually did that this year. We had decided the night before to trade, to try to get back into the fourth round with an extra pick, because there was a player of value that we had at least a third round value on in Shamarco Thomas. So we were willing to give up a future pick. So you really just systematically go through it. And it's, you know, but way back when, it worked out great for Troy, and hopefully the same type of thing works for Shamarco. But really, I can't think of any anecdote that really made it, that memorable, other than Troy being a great player. You know, it's kind of a boring process, really.
Okay.
If you guys really were disagreeing on someone and it was fairly split, I mean, who has the tie-breaking vote? Or do you convince each other? Or is it you? Or is it the Roonies? Or, I mean, who's, okay, you can't agree, we're taking this guy.
Yeah, you know what, Guy? The 3.5 weeks that we spend together sorting through all the information, that's when the disagreements occur. And, you know, they're healthy disagreements, they're healthy discussions. And then collectively we'll come, you know, and I'll orchestrate the meetings in conjunction with Coach Tomlin. And you know, Art is in on most of the sessions, especially in positions of interest. And, you know, we just go through it and discuss it. And of course, there's disagreements as you're putting it together. But once it's put together and we assign that final grade, which I'm responsible for, everybody gets their chance to have input. And once it's settled, it's settled, and nobody speaks against it.
Do you like it being stretched out over 3 days? Does it make it easier because twice you kind of get to sleep on it, reassess, and instead of it just continuing to happen during the day? Is that a little bit easier for you?
The politically correct answer is yes. The real answer is no. I'd rather run right through it. You know, in the old days, and I'm dating myself, but we'd start at start at noon and finish at 2:30 in the morning when there was 12 rounds. Now, that's a little bit crazy, and I understand that the fan interest and the TV, possibilities and for the game and marketing, you know, the draft and the combine and all those things. I get all that, but from a personnel man standpoint, I'd rather do it in, really, you could do it in 2 days. I think you could have rounds 1, 2, and 3, and then 4 through 7, I think would be more compact. There's a lot of lead up time. And again, we've just spent close to a month putting it together. So we're prepared, and it's just like, okay, we get one pick, and then you get two picks, and then you get, you get one pick, two picks, and then four picks. It's just, to me, it's too long of a process.
Talking with Steelers general manager Kevin Colbert here on Ken and Guy. The Le'Veon Bell selection, Kevin, were you guys looking for a certain style of running back at all? Through your tenure, you've had different types, Jerome Bettis, Willie Parker. Was there a certain fit you were looking for, and why Le'Veon?
Well, Le'Veon was really, he was very interesting to us because we looked at him as an NFL back. He had 1,700 yards last year and close to 900 of those yards were yards after contact, which indicates the ability to make NFL-type runs because the holes in the NFL aren't going to be the same as they are in college. So you saw him make a lot of what we thought were NFL-type runs, and even if he only had a one-yard hole that was blocked, once he made contact, he always seemed to fall forward for four more, and that was intriguing. You know, his ability to catch and his ability to block were also intriguing. So in Le'Veon, we thought we had a complete package. And there were several other backs that, we liked as well, but, not as well as Le'Veon.
We've discussed the draft a lot on the show this week, Kevin, and what a lot of our emailers were interested in was the running back pick and also the quarterback pick. And I thought you wrapped it up real well in your post-draft press conference as the philosophy of taking Landry Jones. If you could just sort of reiterate that for us and what you see in him, because some people are like, is this the heir apparent to Ben Roethlisberger one day? So if you could just sort of sum up the thinking process of taking him.
Yeah, first and foremost, we hope that Ben plays here for, we hope he plays his whole career here. We hope he finishes here. We hope he still wins us a few more Super Bowls. I know that's his goal, and would love to be able to have Ben finish what he started. And when that comes, nobody knows. But in the meantime, it's our job to provide depth. It's our job to provide talent, at any position. And, sometimes you can neglect the quarterback position when you have such a great player like Ben in the earlier rounds. And it's understandable because we have to also surround him with the talent he needs to succeed. But, this draft was unique. I said it prior to the draft that, a lot of people were kind of belittling the quarterback class. And I said, I think there's several players in this group that will be good NFL quarterbacks. And, of course, Landry was in that group. And what you saw in the fourth round was four guys being taken by teams that have a quarterback that's, in his early 30s. And I think everybody did it with the same thought in mind. They wanted to get a young guy in the mix. And, you hope that guy may never play until your quarterback moves on. But, you better be prepared in having a young guy in it. And not to take anything away from Charlie or Byron, because they certainly bailed us out, throughout their tenures here. But we wanted to be able to stabilize that backup position with more of a or less of a year-to-year type proposition. And we tried to do that with Bruce Gradkowski signing a 3-year deal. And really, Bruce is a young backup, and we wanted to get another young player in the mix. And when that group was available in the fourth round, we had the extra pick because we were able to make the trade. We thought this was too good a value to pass up, and we made the pick.
Landry played a lot of spread, it looked like, at Oklahoma, Kevin. Is it hard to evaluate how he might fit with you guys? Or conversely, are you sort of excited to get him in if you can protect it up and let that arm play?
Yeah, I mean, really, Kenny, when you watch any spread offense, there's some things you have to sort out when you do it. I mean, there are some, you know, very, I don't want to say they're easy throws, but there's not a lot of reading, optioning, those types of things. It's more of a pitch and catch. And you even see some of that in our game right now. And you would hope that anybody that's an NFL quarterback could make that throw. You would expect that. But there's also a point in time where even if they're in a spread offense, it still becomes a read. Even if they're in a shotgun, it still becomes the ability to step up in a pocket, you know, to read the coverage, to anticipate the receiver's breaks, and to have the ability to make the throw. So throughout the course of a play, even in a spread offense, there's things that you're going to look for that the player will have to do in a conventional offense. You know, they all, even if they eventually, they all would take a snap under center at some point. You may not see a lot of it, but even Ben was like that when he came out. You know, he didn't play under center a lot, but you could see he had the talent to do it. So you just try to sort those things through.
Tell us a little bit about Golic's kid and his, you know, whether with you guys or anywhere else. He's a guy that can make a living on Sundays for a while, do you think?
Well, you know, he has the chance. He, you know, when we tried to sign the free agents, we tried to sign guys that were position flexible. And, you know, Mike Golic Jr. has played both center and guard. He has experience at both. You know, he played along with a guy named Braxton Cave out there at Notre Dame, who was their primary center. But he also played some center when Cave was injured. So the possibility exists. The position flexibility is what's intriguing, not only with Mike, but with a lot of those free agents that we signed.
Hey, last one for me, Kevin. The Marcus Wheaton pick. When you're looking at a fast wide receiver, like Marcus obviously is, you've had guys like Mike Wallace come in and obviously be terrific, productive for you. And then there's been a few others. Willie Reed comes to mind, who was so fast and quick but just never translated. What makes the difference for these guys? Why do some stick and some don't?
Yeah, I just think it's productivity. You really watch. You just see who is productive. And, you know, Mike's speed was unique. There's nobody. I mean, he's the fastest receiver in the NFL, and he plays fast. So, you know, his speed was unique. So anybody you compare or look at in comparison to Mike will pale only because nobody's that fast. When you look at a Marcus Wheaton, you see productivity as a receiver where it lines up from a split position. He lines up in the slot. He catches short balls, but he also played fast and could get deep. When you look back on a Willie Reed, you know, Willie was really renowned for being a punt returner, and you know he had great stats at Florida State, and you know he had that potential with us. You know, unfortunately for him, after his foot injury, he never was quite as fast as he was in college, and you know he didn't last too long in the league. So, you know, he was, you know, again, Willie was more known for his punt return abilities, where I think a guy like a Marcus Wheaton is more well known for really the inside-outside capabilities.
Well, we know what a big hockey fan you are, Kev. Were you able to make it down to game one last night?
Absolutely. It was great. You know, they just kept the Islanders. The Islanders never really got into that game, and it wasn't because of you know, I didn't think any poor play on their part. I just think that the Penguins dictated that play, and you can just see a hunger with these guys. And you know, I know their objective is to flush that out of their system, and you know, respect the challenge they got tomorrow night. And I'm sure they'll be up to it.
Kevin, always great chatting with you. Look forward to seeing you over the weekend with rookie minicamp.
All right, guys, you take care.
Thanks.